YouTube channel. Well, we're on the beautiful campus of Yale University in New Haven, Connecticut. Just finished another conference from the Society for Scientific Exploration. This is a organization that I'm interested in, that you're interested in too. The first time I presented here was about anomalies in crop circles, electromagnetic effects, and so forth. And then a couple of years later, I presented a presentation about what remote viewing tells us about UFOs and extraterrestrials. Now, last year I presented to the SSE, the Society for Scientific Exploration, presentation about multiverse ideas, multiverse models, some of the original idea, the so-called many worlds theory that came out of the work of Hugh Everett III from the 1950s, but we didn't hear about it until the 1970s, and now it's become much more popular, the idea that you're constantly splitting off into separate realities every nanosecond or so. And most recently, I made a presentation to them this time about implications of multiverse models, specifically the many interacting worlds theory on our ideas about creativity, what our personality is, whether we exist in multiple realities at the same time, you know, parallel realities, all that cool stuff that we used to think of as being science fiction, and now it's starting to enter the realm of science fact, or at least science speculation. You know, what does it imply if we live in a multiverse with parallel realities, with different versions of yourself and other aspects of reality, you know, right in the same space that we're in here, but just perhaps at a slightly different frequency. And if they interact, what happens? Okay, so that's what the following presentation is about. I hope you enjoy it. And as usual, let me know what you think. Put your comments in the box below, and we'll talk to you soon. Take care.
Every now and then, I meet a new venue. A few years ago, it was England crop circle. And a year after that, it was...
Actually, thanks for my trucker. Thanks for having me here today. Actually, my academic career started right here in Connecticut. I went to a little university down the road from Yale, Wesleyan University in Middletown, where everyone who did get into Harvard, Princeton, and Yale went. So it's actually a local connection to this area, having grown up in the Northeast. So anyway, I gave you guys a presentation sort of like this last year at SSE, so I'm gonna review just some of those ideas and then go on to how I think multiverse models can help us explain a lot of these phenomena and show us that they're not really weird after all, they're just normal, okay? I always kind of, I like this quote from Pasteur because, you know, astonishment is something that we all go through when we get involved in these phenomena. I mean, as Roger mentioned, it started for me with Gordon Brown's remote viewing course, and then he would give us kind of non-ordinary targets like remote viewers are apt to do, things like UFOs and crop circles. Of course, they're not verifiable, but you get curious. So from RV, you go to crop circles, UFOs, channeling, near-death experiences, and I recently encountered someone who had a close encounter with Bigfoot. So I think I've got the entire set almost of non-ordinary phenomena. So I want to explain to you why I think the many interacting worlds model can help us understand some of these phenomena. It is a kind of realist model that's based on the idea that we are surrounded by trillions of parallel realities, real physical parallel realities. They're perhaps at slightly different frequencies than our own. And so you're wondering, where are they? Well, it's the same way with radio signals. You don't see them right now, but they're right next to you. Something like that. But it all goes back to Hugh Everett III. He matriculated to Princeton in 1953, and he posed a direct challenge to the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics. Everett was a very smart guy, and he kind of took Copenhagen and turned it on its head. If you'll recall, with Copenhagen, we had this kind of dualistic interpretation where Niels Bohr and others have concluded that perhaps there is a quantum reality, but we can never know it directly. We can only know it through classical experiments. You don't have any direct experience of it. And the classical world that you and I have of direct experience is the only one that we'll ever know. And so This basically reduced quantum mechanics to a type of mathematical measurement system, a black box, if you will, where you really can't get inside the calculations. You're just told to accept them without having any real method to understand what's going on below the surface. So you're basically told, you know, don't ask, don't tell, just shut up and calculate. And Schrödinger himself was kind of disturbed by this because he was always posing the question, why don't we observe macroscopic states? And there's this quote from him where he's saying, you know, it's actually really disturbing even to think about it because everything would be amorphous, ghost-like, like jellyfishication, right? And why don't we perceive the world in those macroscopic states being macroscopic creatures ourselves? And the interesting thing to note about the Schrödinger wave equation, his solution to this, he actually didn't create the wave equation. The reason the atomic model developed like that came from the mathematics of acoustics. And I don't think Ron is here in the room, but our very own Ron Westrum has given us lectures before about Chladni, right? Ernst Chladni? But in reference to meteorites. And Chladni was the first one to propose the extraterrestrial theory of meteorites, because at the time it was thought that nothing could fall out of the sky, because Aristotle had basically said there's nothing beyond the moon that's really moving. It's static. And Chladni, by the way, Chladni and other mathematicians at the time, Euler, Lagrange, Laplace, created the mathematics of the waveform which Schrödinger used. In fact, Schrödinger didn't even have to create any of the math, at least for one electron atoms. It was all created hundreds of years before, which is kind of interesting. But it basically shows us that quantum mechanics itself has its origins in classical physical processes. Chladni invented the idea of nodal modes. Now, you've all seen this in terms of cymatics. And the reason this looks like the orbital patterns of atoms is because that's where the math came from. Now, these, I believe, are in the Explorer Museum in San Francisco. But you may have seen Dr. Hans Jenny, some of these videos on YouTube. There's another fellow, Lauterwasser, who's done this with water. But that's why it looks like orbitals, because this is where orbitals come from. It comes from a classical, real-world physical process. And even Michael Faraday himself, the idea of lines of force, field lines, as we call them now, comes from Chladni's nodal modes. So it's pretty significant in physics, this idea of acoustics and physical waves. So one of the proposals how to deal with the dualistic interpretation of quantum mechanics is to say that this Schrödinger wave equation, the waveform, collapses, okay? And that it collapses from measurement, from observation, and it reduces this field of possibilities just to the observation you're making at the moment. And so the collapse idea became pretty important component. Why do we only see one level of reality, one aspect of it, when we're told that it actually represents all possibilities at the same time? Now, Everett didn't buy the collapse theory. He thought that quantum mechanics should be its own independent area of physics without any reference to classical mechanics. That there is nothing to collapse the Schrödinger wave equation, and that that's kind of more like metaphysics or philosophy than science. It's just an ad hoc idea that you're throwing in there. You can't really justify this idea. It's just something that you're making up. You're doing the best you can, but there's no evidence for it. So he proposed that because the observer is also in a superposition, the quantum wave never collapses. It's all quantum wave all the way from the subatomic level to the largest levels of cosmology. And that you actually have all the different states that the wave equation describes. He didn't invent this idea entirely on his own. Von Neumann suggested the idea of psychophysical parallelism. And this is really significant. This is where multiverses start, as far as I'm concerned. And as the previous speaker mentioned, you can read more about this from Max Tegmark's work. But von Neumann suggested that subjective states are as mathematically real as objective states. It's very significant. There is nothing less real about subjective states than objective states. And so Everett took this and turned it into what was later called the theory of the universal wave function. And this is the idea that the wave function never collapses, it keeps going, and you're expanding to be in each one of these states every nanosecond with every observation or every perception. It's not quite clear, but that's that's the idea. This later became known as the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics. And the idea is that every time there is a physical measurement, the most conservative way to look at it, that there's a splitting process and that the universe splits. And you keep splitting with it. So you're observing both outcomes of both experiments, both outcomes of an experiment at any one time. Now, it's interesting that Everett went over to Copenhagen to tell this to Niels Bohr. This is the actual photo. Everett's on the right there, with Niels Bohr in the middle, and they did not want to hear anything about this. And Niels Bohr was such a powerful figure in quantum mechanics that he basically, John Wheeler, Everett's thesis advisor, backed down and wouldn't let him do this dissertation. It became known as the relativistic states theory of quantum mechanics. Right? So we didn't hear about it till the 70s, but it goes all the way back to the 50s. I mean, we heard about it on Star Trek and so forth. But that was really the end of it until a conference in Austin, I believe, in 1978. But it wasn't discovered again until the early 1970s. Talk about scientific suppression and authoritarianism. So that was one version of the multiverse. There's a newer version of it, which, if Everett attempted to get rid of wave collapse, this newer version of many worlds attempts to get rid of the quantum wave, period. It basically says that what we perceive as a quantum wave is the interference pattern of multiple realities, parallel realities, interfering with each other. It's almost like if we were to make a lot of noise right now and we stopped, there would be an echo. That's what the quantum wave is. It's a residual static factor left behind by interactions of multiverses. In other words, this is one of the papers that you could read about it. It came about independently from these guys, Hall, Deckard, and Wiseman, and also Bill Poirier at Texas Tech. And it basically says that quantum phenomena are the outcome of interacting parallel realities. And that the quantum wave itself is not the cause, it's the effect of interacting parallel realities. Now the interesting thing about that, basically they're arguing that it's kind of like an epicycle. It works mathematically, but it's not the ultimate explanation. And if you shift your view, like people had to do in the past, from the geocentric to the heliocentric view, that we're not the center of the universe, you have to do this too with parallel realities to realize maybe there is no quantum wave, as heretical as it sounds. So essentially, the many interacting worlds theory is Broglie-Bohmian dynamics, which says that there's a type of pilot wave, but it's that interpretation on steroids, because if you add the many worlds interpretation of Hugh Everett, you have a multidimensional pilot wave coming from even all directions. And this is very much like cellular automata, Stephen Wolfram's idea that I came across a long time ago in graduate school. Basically, you don't necessarily need big theories to explain things. You can take single automata, program it into a computer with the rules of their interaction, and you can build the same models from the ground up instead of from the top down. And this is exactly what the people who study MIW have done. They basically suggest to us that almost all the time, we live in a classical reality, but sometimes these parallel realities interact and create interactions between worlds. This is literally what they suggest. It's kind of like raindrops on a window. A lot of the times they don't interact, but sometimes they can join together and all of a sudden they're moving, and it goes all the way to streams, all the way into the ocean. Simulations of this model show that you only need 41 parallel realities per electron to reproduce the double slit experiment and quantum tunneling. The MIW approach reproduces all of the effects of quantum mechanics without the quantum wave. And this is just one example of the double slit experiment. The white in the background is what you would see from an experimental result. The simulation are the red and blue lines. The more parallel realities you add in, the closer you actually get to the experimental results. So MIW doesn't prove that the quantum wave doesn't exist. It just shows there's an entirely different way to get there, and it yields the same results. So is the quantum wave actually like the epicycle? You have to ask yourself that. So MIW, so far, the limit is MIW exists if all parallel realities interact, and we can only simulate so many in a computer at one point. So the limitation is computing power. But the founders of MIW say that you can no longer rule out interactions with other universes. This is literally what they're telling us, that they interact sometimes. You can bleed through from other realities. They even talk about interworld potential. So for me, as someone who studied a lot of these interesting phenomena since I got involved with RV, this explains quite a bit, because traditional quantum mechanics says that quantum entanglement, as a previous speaker mentioned, doesn't exchange information, and other interpretations, multi-worlds, tell us they don't interact, like the Hugh Everett model. But this model says they interact a little bit, somewhat. And another interesting aspect of MIW is that it suggests the idea of supernonlocality. Supernonlocality is that our reality could interact with another parallel reality, and that reality could interact with another place in your world, so that you're interacting with another place in your world. You don't even have to make reference to another one indirectly through the other reality. And this could have reference, could have impact on phenomena like PK, or even, and this is something I actually saw in Japan, a guy who could really do PK really well. He was able to levitate objects across the room into your shirt pocket. But basically, the corollary of this is that there are unexplained realms within our own world that we're not interacting with yet, kind of like Ron's presentation yesterday about portals. So how would we apply this, since this is what we're talking about? We were talking about this at lunch, apply consciousness. So, I mean, Richard Wiseman, who's not really a friend of the subjects we study, nonetheless wrote an interesting book that people, he pointed out that people in therapies that act a certain way begin to feel like they've been that character their entire life. There was a psychologist, George Kelly, who found this. You may be familiar with this movie or book from a woman in the 50s, Christine Sizemore, who had multiple personalities, now referred to as dissociative identity disorder. How do you explain someone that one of the personalities has physical allergies, then they shift to another personality? They don't have those allergies anymore. They're physiological shifts, and some of you have talked about that in your presentations. So this goes way beyond the subjective. We're actually talking about physiological changes within our own realities. Very hard to explain from any traditional models like that. You may have seen the movie Split recently, which talked about this. I mean, the character has these different diseases based on which personality So here's an example of one case I heard. This is Daryl Anka. He channels an MC named Bashar. I came across this in 1986. This is how Daryl sounds when he's not channeling.
This is a channeling. A channeling is a state. I believe personally that channeling is something that everyone can do and that everyone actually does do from time to time. When you get out of your own way, when you allow your own creative energy to come through,
you've noticed that when the person who's channeling, he channels an entity named Bashar, it's quite a different personality. How do we explain this?
I don't say good day to you this day of your time. How are you all? We will take this opportunity once again to thank, first of all, each and every one of you individually, and all of you together collectively, for allowing for the co-creation of this interaction and this communication through this particular gate on this day, in this way, at this time.
I think this multiverse model, because it's basically a math model from the ground up, and start explaining this, basically that there are different versions of you in parallel realities, and sometimes they interact with the version of you that's here right now. Another example, psychic surgery. I ran across this fellow, Masa Amaki, in England when I was researching crop circles, which Roger knows about because he luckily came with us 1 year. And this is Masa Amaki, he had gone down to Brazil. He considered himself to be a debunker, and he was going to debunk this guy. Here we are making a crop circle, by the way. This is legal, the farmer was paid, and it's a lot of fun. We're doing his experiment to look at static charges and so forth. And what you find with some of these psychic surgeons or channels or similar phenomena is that there's this sudden change. Like, you can call it a sudden somatic transformation. Something in their body changes quite quickly. This is Maki actually showing us a video of a friend of his who was getting operated on by Dr. Fritz. I'll show you this picture in a second. The guy actually put a circular saw into his neck. There's blood spattering everywhere. The patient felt no pain, walked away from it, and felt better after the operation. So it's very hard to explain from the kind of classical way of looking at things. This is Dr. Fritz. Rubens, when he's not channeling, he needs thick glasses. But as soon as he becomes Dr. Fritz, he doesn't need his glasses at all. Now, some of you are wearing glasses. Can you imagine another version of yourself that just instantly doesn't need? How do you explain that? He treats hundreds of people a day, and a lot of them say they feel better. I met someone recently in a conference in Miami, and she had been treated by him. She knew other versions of Dr. Fritz that had been channeled by different people who described similar phenomena. There's also Luis Gasparetto. You can see him on this video, UFOs and Channeling, hosted by Telly Savalas. It's on YouTube. Now he's a motivational speaker, but he used to be able to become 20 different types of artists, really do very good artwork, just from one of them tonight. So you could look at it as a continuum, a creativity continuum, from just a mild amount of creativity and change, and maybe some of your musicians or amateur painters, to someone who is a professional actor, musician, all the way to channeling multiple personalities, dissociative identity disorder. You all know who this is, right? Vincent Damon Fernier, right?
Alice Cooper.
That's right. Alice Cooper told us in his movie, Super Duper Alice Cooper, that the Alice Cooper personality was so destructive, he had to limit him to the stage. In other words, certain musicians, actors, the personality could become destructive to the actor or the musician. He even became an alcoholic, drug addiction, so forth. He had to basically become Vincent off the stage and Alice on the stage. It's that powerful. And so you have to ask, are these really two different personalities, parallel realities, or meeting in some way? I mean, how would you explain it? It's another way to look at it. Jeremy Brett, Sherlock Holmes, he had some quotes, a great actor, but he had some quotes that the Sherlock Holmes character was really powerful. And they kind of absorb the character like a liquid. And then it's even kind of scary. He actually, when he died, he was smoking 60 cigarettes a day, just like Sherlock Holmes would. So this is real. And maybe some of you know people that have DID or something like that. It's a really fascinating thing. Remote viewing, bilocation, there can be a shift where you actually feel like you're at the target site and the room disappears there. So this is kind of a pressure-based model, pressure from other realities. We know that in crystals, pressure can create superconductivity, a type of quantum effect, coherent flows in liquids. It's another way to look at it. Some people have written about adjacent possibilities, Steve Johnson in his book, Where Good Ideas Come From. Maybe the adjacent possible is really another physical reality, but we're not perceiving it directly. It's not just a metaphor. Pair labs, bonded pairs, how would you explain that? Two people double the number of electrons, right? In coherence, are interacting, creating subtle repulsive pressure on our reality. Larry Dossey's twin studies. So basically what we're talking about is quantized consciousness. Quantized consciousness, not quantum consciousness. You get these deliberate shifts, and you have to ask yourself, are you an individual or a multi-individual? I mean, this is where it kind of leads. So our world's mostly classical, partly interdimensional, a little bit interdimensional, but sometimes it comes through, sometimes in some people more than others. And if you reject a lot of these phenomena, I'd say you're committing a type 2 error. You're basically saying, rejecting true evidence. You can see it's real. And it seems, this MIW model seems to satisfy a lot of different physicists, a lot of different ideas simultaneously in kind of interesting ways. It also has implications for gravity, dark energy, and so forth, because we've found that particles moving across the universe seem to lose a little energy, so there's the idea that maybe space-time is leaking due to interaction with multiple other realities, somewhere, something like that. And so basically, the real point is this. When we experience our imagination, are we experiencing real other realities? Is it just subjective, or is it actually objectively real in a way that we just don't completely understand, perhaps in the future? So thanks very much. By the way, these books are out there. You can look at sample copies.